Okay. Because they are recording it, we'll take us straight away to the altar, then it can be seen by everyone. Yes. Will you please stand? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Praise be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our afflictions, and thus enables us to comfort those who are in trouble with the same consolation we have received from him. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I bless the body of Mary Magdalene with the holy water that recalls her baptism, of which St. Paul writes, "All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we were buried together with him, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him by likeness to his death, so shall we be united with him by likeness to his resurrection." On the day of her baptism, Mary Magdalene put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, may she be clothed with glory. We now sing the first hymn, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky."
Thank you.
like to be seated, please. So welcome you to this funeral service of Mary Magdalene Manuel, especially Susan Collin and Craig and all your family members. Yes, she died at a ripe old age, we might say, but still, it is also final. The curtain has come down on her life and we are left to remember her for the person she was and for the influence she had on us. Every time when this happens, as it does also now at a funeral, we should have a deep sense of appreciation and also of gratitude. She is a gift to us all. One cannot forget, or I can't forget, that lovely, open, friendly face. She never left ever after Mass without dragging her son as well to me to say, "We must greet Father." And every time, for me, one of the most astonishing things was that she came all the way from Devil's Peak to church here. And I said, "But why do you drive past all the churches here?" And she said, "We like it here, Father." So we like her here today as well. Even so, we have every reason to be sad because we are losing, we have lost a wonderful person whom we loved. The funeral service is really also to give us comfort. Comfort in the knowledge that death does not have the final say over the life of Mary. That we continue to pray for her and we ask the Lord that he will grant her what we all really want, and that is ultimate peace and rest. Would you like to stand now for the opening prayer? Let us pray. Listen kindly to our prayers, O Lord, as our faith in your Son raised from the dead is deepened. May our hope of resurrection for your departed servant Mary Magdalene also find new strength. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We'd like to be seated for the reading.
I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had disappeared now, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city and the new Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven, as beautiful as a bride all dressed for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice call from the throne, "You see this city? Yea, God lives among men. He will make his home among them. They shall be his people, and he will be their God. His name is God with them. He will wipe away all tears from their eyes. There will be no more death, and no more mourning or sadness. The world of the past has gone." Then the one sitting on the throne spoke, "Now I am making the whole of creation new," he said. "I will give water from the well of life, free to anybody who is thirsty. It is the rightful inheritance of the one who proves victorious, and I will be his God, and he a son to me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Lord, please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to the crowd, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I shall not turn him away. Because I have come from heaven, not to do my own will, but to do the will of the one who sent me. Now the will of him who sent me is that I should lose nothing of all that he has given to me, and that I should raise it up on the last day. Yes, it is my Father's will, that whoever sees the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and that I shall raise him up on the last day." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I'd like to be seated for a moment, please. Dear family of Mary Magdalene and dear sisters and brothers in Christ, we all have known Mary as a fun-loving woman, and Sharon tells me that she did not mind the occasional party, or that she certainly did enjoy dressing up and making sure that not only that she was pretty, but that she was noticed as well, and enjoyed such attention. However, as she also had the joy and the fun of life, she knew also the grief as she lost her husband when he was just in his early 40s. One can imagine that she then had a heart that knew both at the same one and the same time, the joy and the pleasure of life that never left her, and at the same time also a broken heart. And that is why she is the person that she is, of great, tremendous strength and of character. I will never forget how she manipulated, manhandled your brother sometimes if he wanted to escape without greeting, and she made sure that he understood her. But as she came week after week to Holy Mass, there was always a sense that she had a very particular reason for being here. And the reason is that she came to worship the God in whom she believed. She is of Irish descent, isn't it? And her husband was Portuguese. I thought that was the formula for a time bomb, but it did work out for them. And that was something so beautiful about her, was that devout spirit that she had, but also the tremendous respect and the love that one could feel was radiating from her. At least from time to time, I was the beneficiary of something sweet that she brought along. So I'm not sure if you're going to continue that tradition, Sharon. I was only joking, you know. But that is what makes a person, you realize that if you think of another person, that actually is the quality of your own life. When we stand at the funeral service of Mary Magdalene, the person who takes center stage, of course, is Jesus Christ himself. We would have no knowledge of what happens to us after death if it were not for him. We would have no hope, in fact, if it wasn't for his own resurrection. We wouldn't understand that there's a deeper purpose in life if it wasn't for the fact that he revealed to us that there's only one thing that makes life worthwhile and worthy, and that is that we all try to exercise love for one another. The resurrection of Jesus is, in fact, God's greatest manifestation that love prevails over wrong, over darkness, and over evil. Because it is in the power and the strength of love that God raised his Son from the dead. The tomb became, therefore, not a place of despair, not a place of resentment or anger, not a place of aimless questioning, but rather the beginning of a new garden of hope and of life. When we are celebrating, with every good reason, the life of Mary Magdalene, it is because her own life has been grafted on to the life of Christ. In baptism, she became part of the life of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But throughout her life, she could also lean on him for inner strength and for the courage to continue and face also then the battles of life, which she so well managed also to overcome. But we are here really then also to bid farewell to a good and lovely woman, to somebody whom we cherished. Yes, but we have the memories of her, and these memories must remain with us. Because, you know, when Jesus says at the Last Supper, do this in memory of me, it is not as if he invites us to recall the past. It is that in every memory that we have, that we actually have the person present in our lives. And as the time goes by, you'll be able also to maybe even find yourselves ever so often that you are remembering. The first few weeks and months are going to be tough, Sharon, because now, and of course Colin as well, and Lisa, because now, and Craig, because now you'll have to learn to adjust to the fact that whereas you could have used the word mum so many times, that now they will not be able to do so to a person who is alive with you. But she has had, one looks at the dates, a long life and a blessed life. I remember that when you called me, she was still very conscious, thank God for that, and could receive the sacraments. That, I'm sure, was what she would have wanted. And I think that she's very grateful to you that you took that initiative to make sure that she was looked after also in this particular way. The moment of, say, bidding farewell is also the moment of continuity. All of us know that we'll have to stand in front of her and on her shoulders to learn from the values and the qualities of her own life and character. Can we emulate her in our own lives? We know that when we are facing death, as we do at every funeral, there is a moment in which we must realize that it does not end here. It does not end here because we are still to be here for one another. And the purpose of our life can only gain in quality, can only become more fruitful, if we realize that we are there for one another. The life is short. Therefore, we must learn again to appreciate one another in a very special way. Those simple things of care and of gratitude, of pleasing one another and of simply being there are the things that really make life worthwhile. In other words, death is for us again the timely reminder of stepping out of our maybe too cocooned lives and look beyond to be of purpose and also to make sense to the lives of other people. And that is particularly important when we have family. One of the greatest things in life, one of the most wonderful gifts that we can have, is that we have family life. Because it is within the family that we receive the foundations for our own life and for the future. What is, of course, very significant is the realization that each one of us is a gift to each other, is a gift that is to be cherished, a gift, however, that we have to apply and employ in the service of others. We have the best teacher for us in our Lord Jesus Christ. He himself has said that he has come that we may have life and have it in its fullness. In other words, that he saw himself as a source of life and of light, of promotion of the lives of others, of helping others wherever he could. And it is because of that he always helped people to find their connection to themselves, to others, but particularly then also to a God who is a God of mercy, a God of compassion. It is to that God of compassion, to that God of mercy, that we appeal this morning to ask him to grant now eternal rest to our dear sister, Mary Magdalene. And while we're doing so, we reflect also on the fact of our own mortality. We take a moment to pause and to think about the fact that yes, where she is going, we are going to follow as well. And there's nobody who knows the time or the place where this can happen. So it makes us humble. But while it makes us humble because we are not in total control of our destiny, it opens our minds and our hearts to our faith and our belief that God is wise and good, and that whatever he does is good for us. Let us therefore also refer ourselves this very morning to the wonder and greatness of God, yes, to the compassion and the mercy of God. Jesus Christ rose from the dead because the Father made sure that nothing will come between him and the love that he has for his Son. That is precisely where we find ourselves also with Mary Magdalene. Nothing can separate her from the love of God in Christ, but also the bond of love that is woven between us and Mary Magdalene, that bond is now anchored and tied in heaven. It is with that bond that we also raise up our minds and hope to follow her, that we all be united one day with her in heaven. We sing our hymn, Amazing Grace. Like to stand, please. With faith in Jesus Christ, we reverently bring the body of our sister to be buried in its human imperfection. Let us pray with confidence to God, who gives life to all things, that he will raise up this mortal body to the perfection and the company of the saints. May God give her a merciful judgment and forgive all her sins. May Christ, the Good Shepherd, lead us safely home to be at peace with God our Father. And may she be happy forever with all the saints in the presence of the eternal King. In baptism, Mary Magdalene received the life of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. She became a temple of God. In baptism, may she be raised to eternal life, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As our praise and worship of God rises before him like incense, may the soul of Mary Magdalene rise to the Almighty God as a pleasing and fragrant offering. Our response after every invocation is, receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Saints of God, come to her aid. Come to meet her, angels of the Lord.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
May Christ who called you take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's side. Receive her soul and present her to God
the Most High.
Give her eternal rest, O Lord, and may your light shine on her forever.
Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High.
Father, into your hands we commend our sister Mary Magdalene. We are confident that with all who have died in Christ, she will be raised to life on the last day and live with Christ forever. We thank you for all the blessings you gave in this life to show your fatherly care for all of us and the fellowship which is ours with the saints in Jesus Christ. Lord, hear our prayer. Welcome our sister to paradise and help us to comfort each other with the assurance of our faith until we all meet in Christ to be with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Mary Magdalene, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Let us pray. O God, who alone are able to give life after death, free your servant Mary Magdalene from all sins, that you believed in the resurrection of your Christ, May when the day of resurrection comes, be united with you in glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We have come now to the conclusion of our funeral service. I ask the pallbearers to come forward, please, as I give the final blessing. I beg your pardon? Would you like to come up? Time for the eulogy, be seated. Yes, please, do go there.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to read something from my brother. We sat last night and this morning putting something together, so between Jason and Robin and myself, we've written a little something for Granny. Before I open with that, some of Granny's pearls of wisdom used to say, save your tears, my girl, you're going to need them for one day. Can you hear me, Ma? So I think I already cried enough there, so let's get through this. So from Jason, he says, how do you say goodbye? How do you say, I love you, but it's time for you to do in heaven what you so tirelessly did on earth? The world is a colder place without Mary Manuel, my grandmother, the abundance of joy and care that was bestowed upon our family and the families of so many others is now at rest. Her level of empathy and her love for her family and friends shall always be a part of us. It is so difficult to put into words the massive void left behind by someone like her. But if you really knew her, you knew that she is right here, putting her warm hands over yours right now and telling you not to cry. And not to thank her for anything, but to thank God for having her and for letting her love shine upon us for so many years. You arrived with no money and no things. You shall leave with no money and things. Your first bath, someone washed you. Your last bath, someone will wash you. This is life. Why so much selfishness, envy, and malice? We never know when God shall call us home, so be kind to each other and love one another. And remember, JJ, you can't take anything with you, so always give with a full heart, my boy. That was Mary, my grandmother. Growing up, my sister and I always felt so blessed, yet so excited visiting my grandmother. It was like being in the secret lair of the magical Mary Poppins. Surrounded by magical stories, Twinkies, and fun, but still we had to clean up after ourselves. I remember standing in her kitchen in my blue pajamas, staring at her kitchen door, staring with mystical curiosity, as it was the portal to a magical destination like Narnia. While she made me breakfast and tea with her famous pumpkin fritters, everything she did with love in her heart and a smile on her face. When we were children, there were always lots of gatherings and parties, and my gran was the life of all of them. She'd always be the first on the dance floor, but always made sure that she was there to tuck us into bed. I sometimes feel that the years I've spent on this earth are but a footnote compared to the life led by my grandmother. I have never known anyone who could have walked a mile in her shoes, yet she leaves behind a legacy and a set of morals that I shall forever strive to live by and shall pass down to my children and my children's children. My grandmother taught us to always live in love and God, and that one day she would be looking over us from above and showing us that she will never leave our side, and she proved this just last night. After an evening of discussions with my sister and her children, reminiscing about our granny, my wife and I finally put our little one into bed. For the first time in my life, I looked over and saw my wife softly whispering a lullaby into my daughter's ear while she fell asleep, a familiar sound that I haven't heard since I was a child in my grandmother's arms. Round and round the garden like a teddy bear. As tears filled my eyes, I asked where she'd heard the lullaby and why she sung it last night. And she simply said it just came to her, then and there. I know that was Granny, and that she shall never stop showing up and showing us the love and the care that she always has done with such grace and ease since I was a child. God might have her now, but she shall always be right here in our hearts. To all of you that are in the congregation today, I say thank you for paying your respects to my grandmother, and I'm sure that your lives were touched by this angel in one way or another. She loved unconditionally, laughed out loud, never sweated the small stuff, and always made sure that she had a tissue, needle and thread, and something small to mend a broken heart in that Mary Poppins bag of hers. Granny, I love you with all my heart, and I thank you for being the pillar of strength that we could always lean on in times of need. Your legacy has taught me to be a better man every day, to look after those in need, and to always be humble. May your smiling kindness live on forever, and shall we always look up at the stars and thank God for blessing us with your immortal soul. So thank you, Jason, for the tears. All right. Mom asked me to do a eulogy as well. I know I'm standing up for a while, but I got stumped this morning trying to write a eulogy, and I thought to myself, well, let's search what that actually means. And the definition is sharing a remembrance speech. To recall the defining qualities and highlights of a life lived, to capture the essence of a life lived. And if anybody truly lived life to the fullest, it was my gran. I knew her as Granny, others knew her as Mom, Gigi, Mary, Mrs. Manuel, and Auntie Mary. Anyone that did know her will remember her as a feisty little old lady with a big mouth and a bigger heart. So like I said, Jason and I were sharing memories last night, and I already said that part, so it's all good. So like I said, Granny, I promise I'll try not to cry today. That failed miserably. So we ask ourselves, who was Mary? Gran spent her life in service to others. That was no secret. And to the Lord. She loved the Lord more than anybody I know. Her Bible and rosary went everywhere with her. Devout Catholic, she was the driving force to ensure that we never missed Mass, that grandchildren, great-grandchildren were baptized, attended catechism, confirmation, etc. And it was actually in this very church, when I was roughly about 16, that Granny and I had a difference of opinion. We were sitting here and she said, are you going up for communion? And I said, yes, I am. And she said, well, did you go to confession yesterday? So I said, no, I did not. She said, well, why are you going up for communion? To which I responded, I haven't had breakfast yet. So from being a nurse and a midwife in her early years to running a creche called Busy Bees, there was always time for her family and everybody else in between. I remember that even after a long day of looking after 60-odd children, Granny would still offer up her time to go and babysit for parents who needed a night out. She had a memory of note. She remembered every single child that she looked after for the last 30, 40-odd years. She knew the names of every person back in the day that worked at Garden Center, which was her happy place next to church. Not because she needed to go shopping, because she never really needed to. She just wanted to talk to everybody that there was. So you could never just go for a carton of milk. It was 3 hours later, and she popped into Hammer and Tongs and to Pick and Pay and had a chat with everybody. She knew everybody, their life stories, their partners, their dogs, their pets. So if you're going to the shop with Granny, it was not going to be a quick 5 minutes. At least 45 minutes later, you'd have to stand there and roll your eyes and suck it up while she oogled over babies, reprimanded children, gave their parents some really good advice on how to raise unruly kids. For Granny, time stood still in every moment. There was no such thing as rushing her. I can still stand here now and remember Tony saying, come, Mommy. She loved every moment in life, and she was that person who literally stopped to smell the flowers. Also, another thing Jason pointed out last night was Granny just had an uncanny way of reprimanding you without actually reprimanding you. So she helped you see where you went wrong without actually ever telling you that you were wrong. She had an abundance of love to give, and she gave it easily. Never asked for anything in return unless you were going to the shop and she needed the Argus and her lotto numbers. I used to love phoning her. She always answered the phone the same way. Hello, good morning. Even if it was 4 p.m. in the afternoon. I could stand here for days on end and talk about my favorite person in the world, and she really was. And talking nonstop is clearly something I inherited from her. Talking and asking questions through a movie is something her great-grandchild inherited from her. So today is not goodbye, Gran, because she's left behind so many attributes and memories that we can see in everybody that she has left behind. She would say, so don't thank me, thank God for having me. And today, Granny, and every day going forward, we say thank God for you.
Thank you very much, Lisa. I'd like to stand now for the final blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the God of all consolation bless you, for in his unfathomable goodness, he created the human race. And in the resurrection of his only begotten Son, he has given believers the hope of rising again. To us who are alive, may God grant pardon for our sins, and to all the dead, a place of light and peace. So may we all live happily forever with Christ, whom we believe truly rose from the dead. May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you, and remain with you forever. Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Ask the pallbearers to come forward. We now sing our hymn, How Great Thou Art.